was all boys' schools and all girls' schools. And there are many societies on earth where the public schools are, in fact, single sex. I was just in the Middle East. That is, of course, accepted and regarded as normal. But the idea that their boys and girls are so totally different they can't be educated together is obviously absurd. Children can be educated together, but nevertheless, they do have different arcs of development. So let's for a moment think about what are the brain differences between boys and girls. And I talked a little bit about this yesterday, I'm sorry to repeat, but if you were looking at the total psychology of human beings by giving tens of thousands of psychological tests, every way we had of measuring human psychology, if you gave them all to girls, it will fall out on a girl bell-shaped curve. And if you gave the same test to boys, it would fall out on a boy bell-shaped curve. And if you superimposed one bell-shaped curve on the other, so you were comparing the way girls are compared to the way boys are in terms of psychology, they're 85 to 90% overlapping. 85 to 90% overlapping. We're much more human than we are gendered. If you pick two girls at random under that girl bell-shaped curve and compared two girls on any trait, the two girls are more likely to be different one from the other than girls are different from boys. In statistical language, that is, within group variance is greater than between group variance. Right? I'll give you an example. My daughter Joanna is a gifted athlete, not my genes. She's adopted. But she came home one day in sixth grade and she said about the girl next door was exactly her age. She said, "Dad, Maureen says she's going to stop playing soccer. She wants to be a cheerleader." My daughter was playing on an elite soccer team. And she said, "She is such a girly girl." And what Joanna meant to say is on the trait of athletic competitiveness, Maureen and I are very different. And indeed, Joanna went on to play three varsity sports every season of high school, 12 seasons, and played on an ice hockey team where two of her teammates went off and played for the U.S. Olympic team. And Maureen did dance and was a cheerleader, very, very athletic girl, but didn't want to compete. And Joanna only wanted to compete. So you have two very different girls. And then, of course, my son came along, also not my genes, but like his dad, a quite uncoordinated and anxious athlete. And never played on town teams. So you can't say boys are athletic. My son wasn't. You can't say boys care more about athletics than girls. It'd be hard to find a boy who liked athletics as much as my daughter did. Right? I had a girl come up this morning at the end of my assembly with six seventh graders and talk to me about the problem of being a tomboy and being disapproved of by the girls because she liked to play sports with the boys, but being low status with the boys. Really interesting. I said, "My daughter, I know this trip. I know this trip." And we're always, all kids are trying to figure out, where do I fit in with the girls? Where do I fit in with the boys? What kind of a brain have I got? And educators are trying to figure that out too. And what we know and what I talked about yesterday is sometimes school seems to favor girls because they sit more easily. And as one boy said to me when I was interviewing for Raising Cain, sixth grade boy, excuse me, I'm getting a little tired, six-year-old boy, I was interviewing him, I asked him about school and he said, "You can't do anything in school." And I said, "What do you mean by that?" He said, "You can't wrestle, you can't get on the tables, you can't do anything." Right? You can't do anything in school. And that's very often a boy's experience of school. For most parents, well, let me finish about the brain. So I've said the brain is more human than it is gendered, and that individual variation matters more than gender, because within group variation, There's a wide range of what is girl and a wide range of what is boy, and that's bigger than the differences what's boy and what's girl. But I'm a boy expert, so what do I say about the differences between the brains? Steve Pinkert, a professor of psychology at Harvard, says, we now have 60 studies showing meaningful brain differences between boys and girls, men and women. When I was in graduate school, we had no way of looking at the brain when it was operating. We could only look at cadaver brains in the 70s, but now with PET scan, PET scans and MRIs, we have so many ways of looking at the brain while it is functioning. And we are now seeing more gender differences than we knew existed before. But what we don't know is, are they inborn? Or are they produced because we socialize our children differently, or they socialize each other differently? You see, little boys and little girls at 1 and 2 and 2.5 play with each other without reference to gender. And around 3, the girls start to withdraw from the boys. And girls around the world complain that boys play too rough. Okay? And the boys, for a while, they don't know they've been abandoned. But then by 4, the boys are forming groups and they're saying, we're boys, we don't do girl stuff. Girl stuff is stupid. We don't do that. And they're defining what it means to be a boy by saying, it's not girl. And 4-year-old boys often sound like little chauvinist pigs. They sound like they're going to be dreadful men because they're declaring themselves boys and doing boy things. This is quite normal. Boys and girls, even in the most progressive coeducational school, separate for purposes of play. And they separate starting at age 4, and they spend less and less time playing with each other as the years go by, until by 5th grade, at recess, the amount of time that the genders choose to play with the other gender is about 0. And then, of course, by 6th grade, starts to come back the other way, right? And Eleanor Maccabee, the great professor of psychology at Stanford University, in her 80s wrote a book called The Two Sexes, Growing Up Apart and Coming Together, forcing little girls and little boys to play together almost never works. They'll do it if you force them to. No, in a co-ed school, kids should work together. I'm talking about play together, talking about free play. Boys and girls around the world don't free play together. And the boys play together because they are wired for rough and tumble play. That is a fundamental difference between boys and girls that is biologically given. Boys around the world wrestle, right? Girls, some girls wrestle. Some girls like to wrestle with their dads. Most kids don't wrestle with their mom. And some moms get quite alarmed that their son is waiting to pounce on his father when he comes home, and they say, this is upsetting, this is disruptive. I know this because fathers complain to me all the time. I wasn't able to do a father's breakfast here on this visit, but I do father's breakfasts around the world, and fathers are always saying, my wife, it upsets her that they're wrestling, I wrestle with my sons, they jump on me, and my wife says, it's too much, it's too much, it's too much. But kids wrestle. One of the questions I'm asked most frequently, what do I do about my 2 boys? They fight all the time. They never fight all the time. If you took a stopwatch on 2 brothers, most of the time is actually cooperative, or they're watching TV together. They're fine. What the mother remembers is the fighting because it's unpleasant. And she's afraid they won't be friends when they grow up. Because very hard to imagine, for women to imagine, that fighting is a very good way of making friends. This is always, I'm giving women in here a little hard time for a moment, huh? Women and girls fight with each other. I had a 6th grade girl this morning. I said, what's the definition of friendship? She said, well, that's somebody you fight with and you get over it. That's a friend. You live through the ups and downs. But I think many times women don't recognize that boys' roughhousing, assessing your opponent, is a form of intimacy, it's a form of learning, it's a form of testing yourself, and little boys around the world engage in rough and tumble play. I was once at Rockefeller University in New York. I'm not a primary researcher. I had no business being at Rockefeller University. They were doing a fundraiser and they wanted to get a lot of people in, so they had this parenting expert and they teamed me with a great neurobiologist from the University of Maryland who'd been at Rockefeller. Do you know Rockefeller University? Rockefeller University has only 400 students. You can't go there until after you have a PhD. So there are 80 professors and 400 students. Every single one of them is a distinguished scientist. And this distinguished neurobiologist was talking about the absorption of hormones in the brain and the brain differences between males and females. And she showed films of her white lab rats in a glass tank, and the male lab rats were all up front rolling around, pummeling each other and wrestling, and all of her female lab rats were in the back licking each other and grooming each other. And she showed this film, and then I showed my boys at recess in Kevin's class, right? Playing touch football turns into tackle football, and they're all rolling in the wet grass, right? And her rats and my boys are doing just the same thing, boy stuff. And it's a way of getting close. It's a declaration of friendship. And we need to understand and give boys space for this, because this is the way boys develop bonds. It makes some boys anxious, made me anxious when I was a little boy, but it's a very, even my own very anxious son always wanted to wrestle with me. And when he had one friend over, he didn't like pack wrestling, okay? But with a safe friend, you wrestle, and we know that all primate males do it. Does it make them aggressive? The greatest fear I run into in elementary schools is teachers who are afraid that boys' interests, that boy play, will turn into violence, that boys will get out of control, and people will be hurt. I work at an all-boys school, 440 boys, grades 7 through 12. A lot of our boys repeat because we're such an athletic powerhouse. Their fathers want them farther down the road of puberty, so they can make a bigger impact on sports teams. We sometimes have 14-year-old seventh graders, which I regret. But a 13-year-old, a seventh grader starts at 13 is okay. But a 14-year-old starting in seventh grade, the problem is we've got a seventh, you know. It makes it very hard to put our sports teams together, because there's such a disparity in size. I lost my place mentally. I'll get back to it. I was talking about people's fears that boys will get out of control, and I was saying the psychologist for a school of 440 boys. I haven't been there for 20 years, and in 20 years there have been two serious fights where boys were really out of control, really trying to hurt each other. Two fights in 20 years. Now, sometimes we hear about fights at parties between one of our boys and a boy from another school, and it's usually because they've been drinking and they're challenging each other about athletics, and it's a bar fight. Not attractive, but probably inevitable. But fighting does not make you, it does not make you a dangerous man. Sumit, when did you have your last physical fight? Don't remember. Your last physical fight, 10th grade. Your name again? Lance, I knew that. Lance, you had was a serious really go after him, and you've not fought since? No criminal behavior since? Not so far as you know, right? Your last fight? Fight with your brother? Yeah. Did you continue to wrestle with your brother later on in life?
Into high school.
I've had women tell me that their brothers come to family reunions and still find some reason to wrestle with each other into their 40s. Have you ever seen that? I've just never seen that between women at a family reunion. Right? So one of the things you have to understand about boys is that they are, their physical activity and their rough and tumble play is not leading toward dangerousness. Yeah. He's not a rough and tumble guy because there's a wide range of what's boy. And some boys don't like to be hit, right? I did not like to be hit particularly, but with my brother it was absolutely necessary for survival. Do your boys fight?
They kind of whack each other every now and then.
They whack each other every now and then.
But it's not like,
they're not
rolling around wrestling. They're not.
One punch and it's over. Yeah. Okay. Well, that's.
Because the older one isn't a rough and tumble.
Yeah. Okay. Stylistic, it's temperament. What I'm just saying is it's not dangerous to me.
We have three boys.
Yes. Yes, 11, 9, and 8. Yes. Yeah. Always stirring up trouble. Always competitiveness. I'm better at this than you. You're stupid. You can't. So people always ask me, what do I do about it? My sons are fighting all the time. I was down in Costa Rica, and my mother said, Dr. Thompson, I have a 10-year-old boy and an 8-year-old boy, and they fight all the time. What should I do? It's just awful. And I said, are they pretty evenly matched? That is there a huge weight disparity? Well, the older boy is a little bit bigger. Does the 8-year-old start stuff? Does he provoke his older brother knowing that it's going to get bad? Oh, yes. Oh, yes. All the time. He's always starting stuff. I said, have they ever hurt? Does the older boy then totally dominate the younger boy? No, sometimes I worry the younger boy is going to dominate his older brother. I say, any serious injuries? Broken bones, broken teeth? No, no. Blood? A couple of times. I said, leave the room. She said, but what am I supposed to do about it? I said, leave the room. Wish the young one, the younger one, good luck. Don't always become the person who's trying to sort out what the boys need to sort out on their own. The 8-year-old has to learn not to start a fight with the 10-year-old if he can't end it, right? I ran into a man in Connecticut, the United States, and he said his mother used to get, he and his brother would fight all the time, and his mother would say to them, oh, go outside and throw rocks at each other. And she would force them to leave the house, knowing that very well that they weren't going to kill each other. But she'd had enough of it. If you're always trying to adjudicate it, if you're always trying to decide it, you're depriving boys of both of the play, but also of the learning of establishing limits and boundaries and mutual respect. And they do. The headmaster of my school is a brilliant and gifted man, has a younger brother who is an extraordinarily successful Hollywood producer and writer. And Rick is the older brother, and Jeff the younger brother. And Jeff flew out from Los Angeles for his older brother's 50th birthday. And Jeff got up and he said, I competed with Rick every day of my life. We competed in everything. I remember that we competed over who would take the last bite of breakfast. And I was the younger and always more impulsive. It was very hard for me to hold back, he said. But I would wait, I would watch Rick eat, and I would wait until I saw him swallow his last bite, and then I would very ostentatiously take my last bite because I'm sure I had won. And he said the second I swallowed, Rick would pick up his plate and pull out the piece of bacon. He had snuck under there. Now, not everybody understands that for many boys, competing, comparing, is a way of testing each other, testing their strength, and being very close. These are two men who love each other a lot. Wonderful fathers, just wonderful men. And they fought. But if you want me to clinch the case, Mahatma Gandhi got into trouble for school for fighting. And the Dalai Lama, when he was picked to be the spiritual leader of Tibet and was moved to a monastery, they didn't want him to be lonely, so they moved him with his brother. But after a year and a half, they sent his brother home because the Dalai Lama and his brother were fighting too much. I love the idea that Mahatma Gandhi and Dalai Lama fought too much as boys. Yes? Well, you have to protect. 2.5 and 3-year-old boys are, well, 3.5, they're beginning to develop self-control. 2.5-year-olds, human aggression in the terms of uninhibited, remorseless human aggression peaks at around 2.5. My friend Ned Hallowell called his son Jack when he was 2.5. They called him the Terminator. They hit anything, do anything, and a little group of 2.5 to 3-year-old boys can be quite dangerous to each other. By 3.5 to 4, the boy issue is beginning to develop self-control. Yeah. Yes. The 3.5-year-old's provoking the 5-year-old. Yeah, yeah. Well, when you're sitting there and it's unpleasant, you have to stop it. So, because you're trying to have a pleasant dinner. Well, what happens? How does it, tell me your name. How does this play out? When the 3.5-year-old, I had the microphone. When the 3.5-year-old is provoking the 5-year-old and they're just in a playroom and where things can't get broken and it's not dinner, well, how does it work out?
So it will go for a whole afternoon.
Yeah, like, yeah.
So from dinner at 5 yeah. o'clock, this starts at the dinner table.
Yep.
And then it will move into the kitchen where they're having a snack, you know, dessert or something. There'll be issues around who got into the fridge first.
Yeah, yeah.
And then once they've had their snack,
yep.
they'll come out, playtime, and the older one will take something off the younger one and say, that's mine, even though it isn't.
Right.
And then that snatch will then maybe result into a clip. And then the younger one comes running to me.
Right.
This has gone down. That's very dramatic.
So what's your question?
So sometimes it goes too far and there might be a bite. There could be...
The 3.5-year-old bites the 5-year-old.
No, 5-year-old bite.
Bites when, the 3-year-old. Oh, that's primitive.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Yeah.
So the little one's been at it all afternoon.
Has he, and then does he break his skin? Is there blood?
No.
So the 5-year-old had self-control?
Yes, there's... That's right.
It was a cautionary bite.
I suppose so.
A warning bite. No, it's really important to watch the older one.
Okay.
If the older one is not hurting the younger one in a serious way when he could do it,
right.
it means the older one is exercising self-control.
Yeah.
His younger brother is actually teaching him self-control.
And it'll have been more like, I don't know.
So the problem is you get tired of this, right?
Well, I get tired of the little one coming into me. You know, with the tears, and he's so loud, and it interrupts, like I might be trying to do something with my daughter.
All right.
And it's like,
so you can separate him and say, I can't stand it. But what I don't want you to try and do is always adjudicate and always figure it out. You can never figure it out. There are just too many provocations on both sides. And this is a source of rich, rich entertainment. For them both.
And the competition thing starts from
yeah.
the minute they get out of
bed. One of the, if there are three differences between boys and girls, it's the greater physicality of boys, the fact that girls use language earlier and more effectively, and use language differently, girls, and that boys engage in what are called dominance behaviors. And these are related to the sexual nature of boys. These are wired in behaviors, and they are just testing because primate males test each other to create a hierarchy. And boys in groups test a hierarchy and then they relax. And they will test each other. Brothers will test each other. Eighth grade boys will test each other. 11th grade boys will test each other. They will test each other. And you have to see whether it's serious and angry and highly emotional or just testing. And you can stop it when you get tired of it. But I'm somebody who believes these are not dangerous. And if your five-year-old is manifesting some self-control with a three-year-old who can be pretty damn provocative, that's a good thing. Now, I look at my watch, and it's close to three, and Maureen's giving me a sign, right? Yeah. So I'm going to, can I answer two questions? And I've seen that people need to go because it must be getting, and it wasn't the most organized talk because I'm a little tired, but I'm going to answer a couple of questions and I will stay and answer questions as long as people want them answered. But I can't pin you all down. Yes, your name?
Kristen,
yes, please.
Hi, I just have a quick question for yes. that 10 to 15-year-old age group, the disorganized,
yes.
lack of focus.
Yes.
If you have a child, or I should say, I do have a child who is aware of this. So
yes.
it's not that he's completely clueless and we're just yelling
right.
at him. He's aware of it. But until that executive functioning really kicks in for him and he can be as successful as he eventually will be, how do we as parents support that? Because I feel like he needs the emotional support
until
he's able to physically do all this on his own.
Yes. What you need to do for a boy is create, during the evening, something of an academic atmosphere for an hour and a half. That means after dinner you clean the table and you ever sit down, he does his homework, everybody else reads. The parents don't sit and watch television. The father doesn't sit and watch television. Everybody sits and reads. And you don't go over the homework with a fine-tooth comb. You just are there. And everybody's reading and reading the paper, reading a book, and he's there and he can ask questions. But you create an academic atmosphere so that it will help him focus. You do help him with organizational. Do you have what you need in the morning? Many boys need their moms to do that. But what you must not do is always save him from calamity. He has to sometimes face a teacher without his homework done, so that he can experience. Unless you have a severely perfectionistic and anxious boy for whom that might be a traumatic nightmare, there are some times when he needs you to not rescue him from everything so he can feel the school of hard knocks, which many boys tell me is how they learn, you know? And it will take a period of years, but you have to stand back and let things happen. Do you wake him up every morning?
Occasionally. He's now waking himself up.
Like,
as we're letting him fail, but where he's feeling the pain. Yeah, where he's not getting an A and he's getting a B, or he's not getting
yes.
a B and he's getting a C. As he feels that on his own, he is getting up at 6:30
Good.
In the morning to review his stuff beforehand. So
Kristen, these are great signs.
Yep.
What I don't want is for you to feel much more about school than he feels. Right? I see moms who care so much about the homework, the boy thinks, really is her homework, right? She certainly cares about it a lot more than I do. And if you overfeel everything, then your son doesn't have psychological ownership. And one of the ways he gets ownership is to occasionally trip and fall. And then he wants to get up at 6:30 to get it done so he doesn't get into trouble. Those are very good signs to me. Those are signs of maturity. One last question. Yes, yes.
I just want to know your thoughts on video games and just kind of the addiction that some kids seem to, the obsession they have, and how good or bad is it? Because it's
What age boy?
10-year-old, and creating the false sense of, you know, achievement and.
What do you mean a false sense of achievement? Those take skill.
Well, it does.
Yeah.
It does. It takes skill, but just to, you know, to work for something and then have it.
How many hours is he playing? A 10, how many hours is he playing a week, or how many hours is he playing?
He's probably playing an hour a day. I don't know, maybe on the weekends more.
Yeah, okay.
And but it's to and from school he's playing.
Does he, is it impossible to get him off it?
No.
Well, that's nice. Mothers are always asking me the same. Dr. Thompson, those video games make boys aggressive, don't they? I say, why do you say that? Well, every time I tell him to stop, he gets angry at me. I said, that's not, right? They have to have practice at stopping. But an hour a day is I'm not an extremist in either direction. I'm not totally laissez-faire, but I'm not a restricted guy. I think an hour a day is reasonable. Adolescents in the United States by the age of 15, both boys and girls, are in front of screens 52 hours a week. Because of school and because of Facebook and social media and cell phones. If you add up all of the screen time, it's two full days, 48 hours, plus four more hours, 52 hours a week. So your son sounds like a 10, pretty reasonable amount. If he's not depressed, if he's not holed up, is he doing well in school?
Yes.
Does he have friends?
Yes.
Does he get some physical activity?
Yes.
Is he polite to his grandparents?
Yes.
Is he mostly respectful of his parents?
Yes.
Not worried. Not worried. And incidentally, no human beings like to be told how to play. Boys play video games. That's this generation's play. Boys don't play outside in groups anymore. They play through the screen. The screen is the new out of doors for boys. They put on this earphones and the speaker, and they join a multiplayer game, and that is what they do now instead of playing out in the woods far away from the house. And most of us are actually reassured to have our boys under our roof playing on the computer. We're wringing our hands about the video games, but we'd be much more nervous if they were out. The modern parent does not want their boy to be with a group of boys out playing somewhere they can't follow. But what they are trying to do is play with other boys and play their games. And they do it in a cyber way. And I had a mother at Belmont Hill who told me that her son was playing a video game. And she said, why don't you go down and see your friend down the street? And he said, I'm playing with him. She said, well, why don't you go down and play with him? And he said, Mom, it's fine, we're fine. And she kept going back. She said, why don't you just go down the street? He's just down the street playing with it. He said, Mom, we're fine. And she kept saying, why don't you go play with it? You should go down and play the street, you know? And he finally turned to her and he said, Mom, it would not be more fun if I were with him. And that's very hard for us to understand. But this generation connects in a way that we didn't. And it's a little foreign and weird to us, but it is their play. And I believe that human beings, the area we should mess with least, if they're not hurting each other, if they're having fun, the area we should mess with least is play. If it's in the context of a balanced life, I'm not worried. Thank you.